following program is a simulcast production by the stations of the Maine Public Broadcasting Network. To enjoy the full stereo effect of this broadcast, we invite you to tune your radio to the Maine Public Radio station in your area and position your television set or your speakers so they're on either side of the television. Turn the TV volume down and enjoy this MPBN simulcast.
The television and radio stations of the Maine Public Broadcasting Network present Live from the Maine Center for the Arts in Orono, Maine, a silver anniversary presentation. MPBN thanks its audiences across Maine and Atlantic Canada for their loyal support. Production and broadcast of Live from the Maine Center for the Arts is made possible in part by a grant from the Sawyer family of companies, committed to a clean environment.
Good evening. I'm Les Myers of MPBN Radio, and welcome to this, the first of three live broadcast concerts from the Maine Center for the Arts, a beautiful facility located on the campus of the University of Maine in Orono. Tonight, from Hutchins Concert Hall, MPBN offers an anniversary gift, as well as an early St. Patrick's Day celebration, the Clancy Brothers, with nephew Robbie O'Connell. They're one of Ireland's foremost traditional and contemporary groups. Appearing first on tonight's program will be a quartet of musicians from southern Maine, the Northeast Winds. They, too, are known for their Irish music. The Northeast Winds is no stranger to the Maine Center for the Arts, having been one of the first acts to play to a sellout audience in this house when it opened 2 years ago. Their music is eclectic, with a repertoire of Irish ballads, sea shanties, and some good down-home bluegrass sounds. The Northeast Winds come from southern Maine, and they've been performing together for 8 years throughout New England, Canada, the Atlantic States, and into the Midwest. The Northeast Winds have made 5 recordings, and as Maine's premier minstrel band, their offerings include traditional and original songs of the sea from America, Newfoundland, and Australia. They also sing Irish action songs, jigs, and pub favorites. Here is the Director of Marketing and Public Relations for the Maine Center for the Arts, Rolf Olson.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Maine Center for the Arts. As the presence of all this light and television cameras might indicate to you, tonight's program is being broadcast live throughout the state of Maine and the Maritime Provinces of Canada by our sponsor for the evening, the Maine Public Broadcasting Network. We're very grateful to the Maine Public Broadcasting System and to the Sawyer family of companies which have provided the substantial funding that covers many of the expenses involved in tonight's program. And now, I'd like you to join me in welcoming New England's favorite minstrels, the Northeast Winds.
The barley and the bran, run like the devil from the excise, smoke of rising barley. Here, there, it would have been me, though, the excise man around the the body and the brand. Run like a devil from the inside, and keep the smoke from rising by.
In a quad to come. There's a pint for good old Father John. They help his prayers and hymns along in the heads of Connemara. Hey, gather up the pots and the old tea cans, the mash, the corn, the barley and the bran. Run like the devil from the excise men, in smoke from rising Barney. Say, swing to the left, swing to the right, for the excise men will dance all night. We're licking up the pay in the broad daylight in the hills of Connemara. And the old tea cans, the mash, the corn, the barley, and the bran. Run like a devil from the excise man, keep the smoke from rising, Barney.
We'll hurry up, boys, and don't be late, for the excise man, they're at the gate. Glory be to God, he's drinking it straight in the hills of Connemara.
Hey, gather up the pots and the old tea cans, the mash, the corn, the barley, and the bran. Run like a devil from the excise men, keep the smoke from rising, Barney. Gather up the pots and the old tin cans, the mash, the corn, the barley, and the bran. Run like a devil from the excise men, keep the smoke from rising, Barney.
Here's the Clancy brothers and Robbie O'Connell are out back getting ready. In the meantime, we're going to entertain you with some songs from Island and Sea, and remember, get rowdy, no problem.
Our first song, our second song, is one that was written about a very famous man from Ireland. He was several things. He was a saint, he was an explorer, and he was a great navigator. His name was Brendan. And what we would like you to do is to help us out in the chorus of that song. It's very simple, very easy to teach, very easy to learn. It just goes, we sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle, we sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle. That's all there is to it. So why don't we run that by you a couple of times and see if you can catch on.
We sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle, we sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle.
Once again.
We sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle, we sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle.
When I was a lad in the Emerald Isle, I heard many stories, both lovely and wild, about the great dragons and monsters that be, that swallowed the ships as they sailed on the sea. Though I was an artist with canvas and paint, I sailed with St. Brendan in his jolly sails. We told the good people goodbye for a while.
We sailed to St. Brendan's fair isle, we sailed to St. Brendan's fair isle.
For 94 days, we came to the spot where the sea was amazed. Those demons from Paddy's were dancing with glee and burning the sailors alive on the sea. St. Brendan walked out on the blistering waves, threw all those demons right back in their cage. And all of the saints wore a heavenly smile.
We sailed to St. Brendan's fair isle, we sailed to St. Brendan's fair isle.
We all went to shore and we walked on the sand. We took our clothes and we killed a zaboo, roasted it up and had a hot barbecue. And after a while we were singing a song, we noticed the island was moving along. So we ate and we drank and we rode in high style.
We sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle, we sailed for St. Brendan's fair isle.
Now Brendan says, boys, this is much to my wish. We ride on the back of the world's largest fish. Hold fast to the rope that is hauling this ship. We'll need it someday if this fish takes a dip. We sailed every ocean, we sailed every sea.
Wonderful. I think the pub crowd's here tonight. A couple of drinks, there'd be no holding this gang back. I can tell that for sure. Especially that bunch up there in the balcony. That's the wild bunch up there. Right? Up there. Well, great. Before we do the next number, I'm going to take a minute and introduce you to my partners.
Wonderful.
My wonderful partners, that's right. We're celebrating 10 years together, starting last month. That's right. Thank you. That's Emory Hutchins over there. Give Emory your great big hand, will you? Make him welcome.
And the lovely young lady who stands next to me on stage, Paula McHugh.
You forgot young, but I'll forgive you. And the man who stands on my left plays every instrument known to mankind and a few that aren't. Would you please welcome Mr. Taylor Whiteside?
And the man originally from Bangor, who is our cherished band leader and paymaster, kindly welcome Alan McHale. Now we'd like to do a tune that comes from the most mountainous of the Irish provinces. And in fact, it's been disagreed with that little piece of geographical information because some people say it's not actually part of Ireland, but we think that the spirit of this tune shows some sort of a connection. It comes from the province of Kentucky, and it's called The Ragtime Annie.
The Irish aerobics. In deference to the old guy's pacemaker, we're going to take it down just a little bit and slow it. It's past his bedtime. I'm only kidding. Sort of. This next song is one that has a special introduction, has a special dedication actually attached to it. A dual dedication, as a matter of fact. The first of this dedication goes to my new husband, as opposed to the old one. I hope neither one of them are watching. I may be in deep trouble. The second part of the dedication goes to myself. It's a song that I have, in all sincerity, adopted as my theme song, in the fervent hope that one day it will take effect. The title of the song is, I Know Where I'm Going. I know where I'm going. I know who's going with me. I know who I love, but the devil knows who I'll marry. Feathered beds are soft, painted rooms are bunny, but I would leave them for to go with my love, Johnny. I'll wear stockings of white, shoes of fine green leather, gold to buckle my hair, and a ring on every finger. I know where I'm going. I know who's going with me. I know who I love, but the devil knows who I'll marry. Love is like a rose, all in the summer sunlight. Love is like a thorn, all in the dark of midnight. I know where I'm going. I know who's going with me. I know who I love, but the devil knows who I'll marry. Some say he's dark, I say he's bunny. He's the fairest of them all, he's my handsome, winsome Johnny. I know where I'm going, I know who's going with me.
This song concerns two sergeants from the Black Watch. You've heard of that Scottish regiment, the Black Watch. There was a time when they had some trouble getting young men to join up, and these two fellows went out across the Scottish countryside, and historical records tell us that they were able to enlist exactly 42 young men, and then things dried up. They ran the risk of not getting their bonus. So they came up with quite a spiel to convince all the young men about what a great deal it was to be part of the Black Watch. It's called the 12 Recruiting Sergeants.
Sergeants from the Black Watch did come through markets and farms to catch recruits one by one. But all they enlisted were 40 and 12, enlist bonny laddie and come along. For it's over the mountains and over the main, through Gibraltar to France and to Spain, with a feather to your bonnet, a kilt upon your knee. Enlist, bonny laddie, and come along with me. And it's in through the barn and out by the fire, your master, this farmer, thinks you'll never tire. You've a
of a very low degree. And this pony laddie, and come along with me.
And it's over the mountains and over the main, through Gibraltar to France and to Spain. With a feather to your bonnet, a kilt upon your knee. And list, my bonny laddie, and come along with me.
Laddie, if you got a sweetheart or a bear, you reason leave it of the Il Spaniard. Oh, rattle though the drum, and that'll be your song. Enlist, bonnie laddie, and come along.
For it's over the mountains and over the lane, through Gibraltar to France and to Spain. With a feather to your bonnet, a kilt upon your knee. And list, bonny laddie, and come along with me. And it's over the mountains and over the main, through Gibraltar to France and to Spain. With a feather to your bonnet, a kilt upon your knee. And list, my bonny laddie, and come along with me. And list, my bonny laddie, and come along with me.
Thank you very much. By the way, they didn't sign up.
I had that problem too. Ah, this next song is one that requires a little bit of history, a little bit of Celtic history. Whether you're or not you're aware of it, the Celts incorporate the Welsh, the Manx, the Irish, the Scottish, the Bretons, and several other people that I've forgotten. Too numerous, actually. But since time immemorial, their collective history has had one common thread, one theme that runs throughout, and that is their love of the land, the yearning for the land. No matter where they've ended up in this world, sometimes involuntarily, that same yearning and love of the land is still prevalent in their lives. Nowhere is that yearning more poignantly expressed than in a collection of ancient poems from the Hebrides that were translated about the turn of this century. And one in particular has inspired this next song. It's called A Song of Exile. From the island bring songs of our sorrow, the cry of the seagulls, the sighing of streams. In all my daydreaming, I'm hearing the waters that flow from the hills in the land of our dreams. Blow westward, O sea wind, and bring us a murmur adrift from our homeland of honor and truth. In waking and sleeping, I'm hearing the waters that flow from the hills in the land of our youth. We sing in this far land song of our exile. The harps and the pipes are as fair as before, but never shall music run sweet as the waters that flow in that land we shall never see more. What song
does the gull sing? What note does the wind bring? Send from our homeland so far away. What whispers the green wave for long after sunset and all through the night till the dawning of day? We sing in this far land the song of our exile. The harps and the pipes are as fair as before. But never shall music run sweet as the waters that flow in that land we shall never see more. When will my heart be free of this longing? When will I finally find peace of mind? In waking and sleeping, the past comes to haunt me. Ties that once strengthened are chains now that bind. We sing in this far land the song of our exile. The harps and the pipes are as fair as before. But never shall music run sweet as the waters that flow in that land we shall never see more.
I'd like to tell you folks that that song there, Song of Exile, was written by Paula McHugh. She just put that song together.
Here's a song about a schooner from southern Maine, from around Kittery Point. She was sent out, or went out, on a March morning in 1904, and did not return. And the mystery has not been solved. This is our interpretation of what might have happened to the Martin Gray. My father was a fisherman, likewise my brothers too. They follow in his footsteps with a wooden point of view. While I, the black sheep of the lot, work safely on the shore. I keep account of what we've got, find ways to make it more. Our mother left for Boston town some 7 years ago. Three sons receive a letter each Christmas time or so. And father takes the dory then and round the harbor roads. Until the weather dries him in, that's when his sorrow shows.
Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray? She was due to fetch the Cuddy Light by 3 o'clock today. No sail on the horizon, no vessel by the quay. Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray?
Now a man's the master of his heart, as boys we all were told. He strains to play the hero's part, a captain brave and bold. But in the end must pay the toll, to feelings never shown. For trapped within this age-old rope, he finds himself alone.
Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray? She was due to fetch the Cuddy Light by 3 o'clock today. No sail on the horizon, no vessel by the quay.
four boats in the harbor. Where's the Martin Bray?
Now father says that one fine day he'd take the gray and gold to an island far beyond the bay that the coast and trade don't know. And there he'll run the mainsail down and anchor by the shore to leave behind old fishing grounds and think of her once more.
Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray? She was due to fetch a cuddy light by 3 o'clock today. No sail on the horizon, no vessel by the quay. Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray? Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray? She was due to fetch the cuddy light by 3 o'clock today. No sail on the horizon, no vessel by the quay. Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray? Four boats in the harbor, where's the Martin Gray?
My turn to make a small announcement. That song, Where's the Martin Gray, is an original composition by Taylor Whiteside.
Okay, now it's your turn to help out again. And the name of this song is Whiskey in the Jar. Is that familiar to anyone here? I suspected the balcony again.
Wow.
All right, here's the way it works. The chorus goes, Mushiringum durum da, and right there we'd like you to clap four times in unison, please. Whack, fall the daddy-o, then twice. Whack, fall the daddy-o, there's whiskey in the jar.
Now as I was going over the far-famed Kerry Mountains, I met with Colonel Farrell and his money he was counting. I soon produced my pistol, I then produced the rapier, saying, stand and deliver, for I am the boldest saber. Mushiringamadooramada,
whack for the daddy-o,
whack for the daddy-o, there's a whiskey in the jar. Well, I counted out his money, it made a pretty penny. I put it in me pocket and I took it home to Jenny. She sighed and said she loved me, she never would deceive me. But the devil take the women, for they always lie so easy. Mushiringamadooramada,
whack for the daddy-o,
whack for the daddy-o, there's a whiskey in the jar. I'm a band of footmen and likewise Colonel Farrell. I drew up me pistol, for she stole away the rapier. I couldn't shoot the water, so a prisoner I was taken.
Mushiringamadooramada, whack for the daddy-o,
whack for the daddy-o, there's whiskey in the jar. Well, they took me to the jail,
good place,
with the judges all a-writin', robbing Colonel Farrell up on Kilgarry Mountain.
Watch out.
I knocked the jailer down, and I bid farewell to this old dicey town.
Mushiringamadooramada, whack for the daddy-o,
whack for the daddy-o, there's a whiskey in the jar.
I'd like to find me brother.
He's the one that's in the army, and I don't know where he's stationed, be it Cork or Old Killarney.
And together we'll be roaming in the mountains of Kilkenny,
and I know you treat me better than my little sporting Jenny. Mosher-ring-a-ma-da-ma-da, back for the daddy-o, back for the daddy-o, there's whiskey in the jar.
There's some that takes delight in the hurling and the rolling. Some takes delight in the carriages a rolling. I take delight in the juice on the valley, courting pretty maidens in the morning, oh so early.
Musha-ring-a-ma-da-ra-ma-da, whack for the daddy-o, whack for the daddy-o, there's whiskey in the jar.
Hey,
musha-ring-a-ma-da-ra-ma-da, whack for the daddy-o, whack for the daddy-o, there's whiskey in the jar. Woo!
Definitely the pub crowd.
No question about it.
We've got a song here for anybody in the audience that might be a Welsh minor. Are there any Welsh miners?
It's two up
there.
Yep, there's one up there.
Huh. See, they spent their life underground. Now they're trying to get as high as they can. Well, the Welsh miners in this song don't have that many options for getting high. They've had to leave their homeland, sometimes their families, go off to the city and try to find some work. They come from the Rhondda Valley in South Wales. Farewell, ye colliery workers, the muffler and the cap. Farewell, ye Rhondda Valley girls, we never will come back. For the mines, they are a-closing, the valleys, they're all doomed. There's no work in the Rhondda, boys. We'll be in London soon.
Farewell, ye colliery workers, the muffler and the cap. Farewell, you Rhondda Valley girls, for you never will come back. The mines, they are a-closing, the valleys, they're all doomed. There's no work in the Rhondda, boys, we'll be in London soon.
My father was a miner, and his father was before him. They always had been proud to work alone. Since they fell neath Brogan's axe, oh, the lads have had the sack. Now away to work in England we must go.
Farewell, ye colliery workers, the muffler and the cap. Farewell, ye Rhondda Valley girls, we never will come back. The mines, they are a-closing, the valleys, they're all doomed. There's no work in the Rhondda, boys, we'll be in London soon.
No more the chapel singing that long ago has left us in the public house. No more the miner's song. For the pit wheels, they are stopping and the population dropping, and I can't afford to stay here very long.
Farewell, ye colliery workers, the muffler and the cap. Farewell, ye Rhondda Valley girls, we never will come back. The mines, they are a-closing, the valleys, they're all doomed. There's no work in the Rhondda, boys, we'll be in London soon.
Tony Penley and Tim Owen, Dusty Bronda, I bid you all adieu.
Farewell.
Or I can no longer wait while Parliament debates. So a fond farewell I bid to all of you.
Farewell, you colliery workers, the muffler and the cap. Farewell, you Rhondda Valley girls, we never will come back. The mines, they are a-closing, the valleys, they're all doomed. There's no work in the Rhondda, boys, we'll be in London soon. Farewell, you colliery workers, the muffler and the cap. Farewell, you Rhondda Valley girls, we never will come back. The mines, they are a-closing, the valleys, they're all doomed.
You have been wonderful and underlined wonderful. We really appreciate your great response here tonight for Northeast Winds. We've got one more to do, and then there'll be a shot intermission, and the Clancy's will be out. We appreciate it. We hope we'll see you soon somewhere along the way. And if you do, come up and say hello. Here's our rendition of the old Orange Blossom Mandolin. Anyway.
Okay, help us out with this one. It's an old shanty called Valparaiso, and it works like this. The chorus goes, Paddy, lay back, take up your slack, take your turn around the capstan, haul away. Now we're going to shout out haul away up here on stage, and we want you to answer ours with a good loud haul away of your own. So we'll show you where to come in on Valparaiso. It was a cold and frosty morning in December, when all of my money it was spent. Where it went to, my lord, I can't remember. Sat down to the ship and off I went. And Paddy lay back,
hey Paddy lay back,
take up the slack,
take up the slack, take your turn around the capstan, haul away.
Hey, all ship station now be handy,
cause we're bound by Valparaiso
down the hall. That day there was a great demand for sailors, for the colonies, for Frisco and for France. So I shipped aboard an army bark, the Hotspur. Well, I got paralytic drunk on my advance. And Paddy lay back,
hey Paddy lay back,
take up the slack,
take up the slack, take your turn around the capstan, haul away.
Hey, all ship station now be handy,
cause we're bound with Valparaiso around the hall. Thank you.
woke up in the morning sick and groaning, and I knew that I was on the way again. Then I heard the major yelling at the door, "Hey, get up, you booger, and answer to your name.
Get out of bed!
Patty lay back,
hey, Patty lay back,
take up the slack,
take up the slack. Take your turn around the caps and haul away. Hey, ho, this day should now be handy. Come around the galloper, eyes around the horn.
Well, I wish that I was in the Jolly Sailor.
Me too!
Along with Irish Polly, drinking beer.
And whiskey!
And I said, whoa, the jolly lads are sailors. And with them a flipper, I wiped away a tear. And Paddy lay back.
Hey, Paddy lay back.
Take up the slack.
Take up the slack. We'll take your turn around the capstan haul away. Hey, old ship station, I'll be handy. Cause we're bound for Valparaiso down the hall.
And Paddy lay back.
Hey, Paddy lay back.
Take up the slack.
Take up the slack. Take your turn around the capstan haul away. Hey, all ship station, now be handy. Cause we're bound for Valparaiso down the horn. Ah, yes, we're bound for Valparaiso down the horn.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to call your attention to the fact that Clancy Brothers, Northeast Winds Record States, and Arthur
Taylor Whiteside, Paula McHugh, Emery Hutchins, and Alan McHale make up the Northeast Winds, which has opened this first half of this live broadcast from the Maine Center for the Arts, the Hutchins Concert Hall. We've come to the end of the first half of tonight's silver anniversary presentation. There's more Irish music in the air with the Clancy Brothers, with Robbie O'Connell, after a station break and a short intermission. You're watching live from the Maine Center for the Arts.
Next on Austin City Limits, the musical wit and wisdom of John Prine.
Dated by birth, none of you are related, is that right?
That's correct, Les. We are not related, but we certainly are great friends, all of us, and have been for a number of years.
I would think you'd have to be working closely together. How did you meet?
We met, I met Paula McHugh first through a mutual friend over 10 years ago, and then very shortly after that I met Emery Hutchins, and for about 8 years we worked as a trio, and then 2.5 years ago Taylor Whiteside came with us, and he came in from sort of an unfortunate accident. Emery Hutchins ended up in the hospital with back problem. And Paula and I had a lot of dates to do and know Emery Hutchins. And someone said, if you can get Taylor Whiteside, he can certainly do the job. And that was true. And Taylor graciously came with us, worked with us while Hutch was recuperating. And he was so much fun and so talented that he just stayed on and became a quartet. And so for 2.5 years, we've traveled around as the four of us.
Now, the Northeast Winds then officially came into being when?
A little over 10 years ago, I'd say. Just a little over 10 years ago.
And you've toured throughout New England and the Maritimes, I understand. Any plans to expand this touring schedule?
Well, if the jobs come in. We've actually been west of Chicago. We've played down into Pennsylvania. And we do a bit of traveling every year with the Clancys as an opening act for them and on our own each year. And we've had a great time, really, in the last 10 years.
Hey, do you have any plans to travel overseas and do some, European gigs?
Not at the moment, but we'd certainly like to.
It'd be fun. And you're a native of Bangor, right?
That's correct. I was born and butted, as they say, right here in Queen City. Not too far from home tonight.
When you were a child, did you aspire to be a musician when you grew up? Was that a plan?
Well, I really always did enjoy acoustic music and guitars and banjos and mandolins. And I in junior high school, I started fooling with the guitar and then the banjo. And yes, quite honestly, I always wanted to entertain people. My first venues, as they say, was playing the banjo in minstrel shows and around Bangor and little small towns.
Now, you're the leader of the Northeast Winds. Is it a dictatorship or a democracy?
It's definitely a democracy. I may be the leader, but I have the least to say, to be honest with you. No, we really get along good about those things. Most all of the decisions are made on a democratic basis, even the business decisions. I try to involve all the members of the group as much as I can, because after all, we all have to go together and we have to do the thing together. So I think it's important that they all understand the marketing plans and where we're going and what the future holds for us.
How do you market the Northeast Winds?
Well, I own a company called Kennebunk River Productions, which is a booking agency. And, of course, we advertise in all the national magazines throughout the United States, such as Musical America and that sort of thing. And, because I also represent the Clancy brothers on their three American tours each year and package some shows. And so that's about how we do it, you know. It's a lot of hard work.
Yeah.
Getting out and digging for the work is what you do.
Well, you also, I know, do some research into some Celtic folk music, Irish folk music, and that kind of thing. How much of this research are you able to do under the time constraints, and where is it leading you?
Well, I must be honest to tell you that the other members of the band probably do more of that than I do. Taylor and Paula McHugh is very much into researching some of the old songs, and the other members of the band very often come up with the new and more obscure songs than I do, quite frankly. Because, as you said, because of the time constraints.
Does any other member of the group write music?
Yes, Taylor and Paula have both written songs that we've recorded. We're about to do on our newest album, which is about three quarters of the way finished now. We're going to do one that Paula wrote called The Song of Exile, and that will be in the show tonight. And also, of course, we recorded the Martin Gray, which was the lead song on our last album, which is Island by Sail, was one that Taylor wrote, and it came out very, very well. I'm very proud of it.
How would you describe your repertoire? Of course, you do Irish ballads and folk songs and Celtic music, but did I hear Cannonball, Warsaw Cannon? What was that?
The Orange Blossom Mandolin.
That was it, the Orange Blossom Mandolin.
Well, yeah, we do a little bit of everything. We do, of course, a heavy emphasis on our show is songs from Ireland and the Sea. We do a few blues tunes, we do a country tune once in a while, and of course the Orange Blossom is a tune that I've been playing for, God knows, 25 years, I guess, and we recorded that on our second album. A little bit of everything, but with a heavy emphasis on songs from Ireland, the British Isles, the mountains, and the sea.
How much, I was watching you there during your sound check, and someone laughed about ad-libbing. How much ad-libbing goes on in an act like this?
A lot of it. We never know what we're going to do, really. We have the basis of the show when we walk out there, but God knows what can happen when the lights go on, you know.
Depends on audience reaction, too,
yeah,
I suppose.
We have a lot of fun, tell a few jokes, and just see how it goes, you know. You have to flow along. If you get too uptight, then I think the audience reacts the same way. But if you're loose and feeling good and having a good time, it reacts with the audience, and we all have a ball. That's what it's all about.
Yeah. Do you see a strong future for this genre of music making?
Well, there's no question in my mind that acoustic music and all the facets of acoustic music is growing. In California today, some of the bands out there are just unbelievably busy. So, you know, I wouldn't say it was just necessarily Irish music or Celtic music. I'd say any form of acoustic music is on the rise. The young people are starting to take a hold of it now, and I'm very happy about that.
Do you do any work in schools?
We play a lot of concerts for colleges and occasionally in high school, but we haven't got into too much of the teaching or that sort of thing.
Could, if someone in our audience, for example, is aspiring to learn this kind of performing, could they come to you as students? Would you be open to that?
That would be kind of tough because of our schedule, although Taylor Whiteside does give lessons on the different instruments that he plays, and he plays just about everything, and he makes part of his living by being an instructor. And it's great.
Where do you go after tonight?
Tonight, let's see. Tomorrow afternoon at 3 o'clock, we have a show along with the Clancy brothers and Robbie O'Connell at St. Joseph's College in Windham, Maine. And we're looking forward to that show. And all the people in southern Maine who couldn't get up to Orono tonight, perhaps they can stop by tomorrow afternoon at St. Joseph's to see us.
Okay, and that's at 3 o'clock?
3 o'clock tomorrow afternoon.
Okay, very good. Alan Mihale, thank you very much.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.
That was Alan Mihale, who is leader of the Northeast Winds. We spoke with Alan earlier today, backstage here at the Maine Center for the Arts. You are watching and listening to a live broadcast from the Hutchins Concert Hall in the Maine Center for the Arts in Orono. I'm Les Myers, your host this evening. We were able to talk with Tom Clancy, also of the Clancy Brothers. Tom, interesting fellow. He has a nimble intellect and a varied range of interests, some of which include the study of history and civilization of man, philosophy, the universe, outer space, poetry, literature, and drama, politics, to exercise his body, for example. He likes to swim and ride his bike. Well, we talked with him about some of those subjects, one of which included acting. Here's that conversation with Tom Clancy.
Tom, you're an actor, I understand.
Oh, I love the way you pronounce actor. Yes, that's good.
Do you have a favorite role or a character that you like to play?
No, not any particular one. Each new play that you get, you kind of savor it and get to love it. The last role that I really loved was in Moon for the Misbegotten. And the old father, who's a crankety old kind of a guy, who just about hates everybody, including one of his favorite lines is, to hell with, not Shell Isle, what is it, Mobile Isle, that they own his property. but I enjoyed playing that. I played that for about 10 months on Broadway with Colleen Dewhurst and Jason Robarts and myself. Then we took it out to Los Angeles.
When you're in a role like that, how do you separate or divorce Tom Clancy from the role you're playing? Do you do it? Can you do it?
Yes. Yeah, well, all my life I've played different parts. I suppose we hide behind different parts, or behind different philosophies sometimes. But I suppose each new part, each part that you play in a play, you have to find yourself within the character that you're playing, whether it be in a Chekhov play. I remember playing in Lopakhin in The Cherry Orchard. Well, of course, I had to find a parallel from my own culture, my own background, to fit in with Lopakhin. Lopakhin in my culture in Ireland, we would call him the gombeen man, which is a term of a fellow who will try to make money or make the best of anything he possibly can at the expense of anyone. And on the surface, he's quite a presentable type of fellow. A lot of bull in front and a lot of nice qualities, but at the same time, you have to watch every move that you make with him, because you won't know when he's taking advantage of you. That was Lopakhin. I found his character in some people that I knew from home, you know.
When you were at home, when you were growing up in school, when you were a youngster, were you kind of a goof off? Did you entertain your classmates?
No, not at all. Strangely enough, I suppose that some actors or some people who go into the acting business or the entertainment business have a tendency to be, you know, forward, show off comics and so on. That wasn't me. I was a studier. I learned poetry and I learned plays and I like to learn things, and the impressions that would go in, they were the ones that I used later on.
I'd like to know about life around the Clancy household when you and your brothers were young, when you're growing up, say preteens.
There was quite a few of us. There was 9 of us. There was 4 boys and 5 girls. My father and mother, that's 11 in one house. And it was in the 30s and 40s that we grew up. And times weren't that good in the 30s and 40s. But our father was a very entertaining kind of a man, and I think we got an awful lot from him. He was a man who was very well read and loved quoting poetry and loved opera. And come down in the morning and he was strapping his razor and singing El Trovatore.
So there was music in the house.
Oh, yes, very much so. And then my mother and my father both sang. They'd sing duets. And my mother had been to America, and my father was supposed to come out to America to marry her in 1911 or 12, and decided not to because the Titanic had sunk, and I think that he was contemplated going on that one. He went back to Ireland. They married and had all of us. And we had a great family life. Just great. Operas and light operas and singing. And all of us were interested in plays and drama, especially in movies, because we had one movie house and we saw every picture that came to town.
Have you done any motion pictures?
Yes, I did two feature films. One called The Killer Elite. Sam Peckinpah directed that. And the other one I did was called The Swashbuckler. We had James Earl Jones and Robert Shaw and Jean-Vivien Peugeot in it. And that was great fun. A pirate. And then I've done a lot of television. Television specials. Like one was Law and Order, it was called, and then there was another one. We did a remake of The Last Hurrah, and then I did several Little House on the Prairie things, and all of those, Charlie's Angels, all of the fun things to do.
Do you see yourself in this dual career of music making and acting continuing now for the next few years?
Well, I'm not going to give it up yet. As a matter of fact, we're booking shows now for 1990, so that sounded an awful long time, a far away date, you know, when we started out, because we've been going since 1958.
1990 will be here in a wink of an
yes,
eye.
Yes, of course.
Tom, thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
That was a conversation with Tom Clancy of the Clancy Brothers. In their concerts, the brothers often weave in extracts from elegant poems by William Butler Yeats or cunning, punning Joyce. The Clancy Brothers have been recognized as being among the principal originators of the current folk revival now being enjoyed in Ireland. But you don't have to be Irish or know a thing about its history and heroes to appreciate the Clancy Brothers. And that's because they've taken the stories, the love songs, the drinking songs, and rebel songs they grew up with and have lent them the poet's grace and touch of pure creativity. In concert, the Clancys radiate a magic spell, and you can put your troubles aside, sit back, and get carried away with the entertainment and begin to think that the world isn't such a bad old place after all. And so in a moment, the Clancy Brothers will be on stage here at the Hutchins Concert Hall at the Maine Center for the Arts. And here is Rolf Olson of the Maine Center to introduce the Clancy Brothers to the audience.
Ladies and gentlemen, as MPBN's 25th anniversary celebration continues, please join me in welcoming the Clancy Brothers with Robbie O'Connell.
Brave young highwayman, the story we will tell. His name was Willie Brennan, and in Ireland he did dwell. 'Twas on the Kilworth Mountains he commenced his wild career, and many wealthy nobleman before him shook with fear. And it's Brennan on the moor, bold, brave, and undaunted was young Brennan on the moor. One day upon the highway, as Willie he went down, he met the mayor of Cashel, a mile outside the town. The mayor, he knew his features, and he said, young man, said he, your name is Willie Brennan, you must come along with me. And it's Brennan on the moor, bold, brave, and undaunted was young Brennan on the moor.
Now Brennan's wife had gone to town, provisions for to buy.
Robbie.
And when she saw Willie, she commenced to weep and cry. He said, hand to me that tenpenny, and as soon as Willie spoke,
she handed him a blunderbuss from underneath her cloak for young Brennan on the moor. Brennan on the moor, bold, brave, and undaunted was young Brennan on the moor.
Now with this loaded blunderbuss, the truth I will unfold. He made the mayor to tremble, and he robbed him of his gold. £100 was offered for his apprehension there. So he with horse and saddle to the mountains did repair.
Did young Brennan on the moor. Brennan on the moor, bold, brave, and undaunted was young Brennan on the moor. Now Brennan, being an outlaw upon the mountains high, with cavalry and
Indian infantry to take them, they did try. They laughed at them with scorn, until at last was said by a false-hearted woman he was cruelly betrayed. Was young Brennan on the moor, Brennan on the moor, bold, brave and undaunted. Was young Brennan on the moor. Hey!
Thank you so much. It's nice to look out and see all those shiny faces. You know, usually when we do our show, there's not all these lights that we have tonight for our television show. But it's such a pleasure to see the faces and see who we're singing to. But that was the story in song of a man called Willie Brennan. Willie Brennan was a real man, and he really was hanged in Clonmel. And he was also a politician before he was an outlaw. And like all good politicians, he robbed the rich, robbed the poor, and kept the whole damn lot for himself. Well, we have many different songs for you tonight, different kinds of songs. We have love songs and work songs and rebel songs. Well, we had some songs that we had to clean up a bit. We left them out for television family audience. But some of these songs, if you know them, please do sing along with us. Some of the choruses are very simple. You can pick them up very readily. And if the person next to you looks funny at you for singing, just belt them. No, not if you love them, of course. But anyway, over here we have Bobby Clancy, who is also from Tipperary, the same place as Willie Brennan. Big brother Paddy Clancy, our nephew Robbie O'Connell, and last but most, Tom Clancy. We'll start off with a little love song that you can pick up the chorus on. This one is called The Whistling Gypsy.
A gypsy rover came over the hill, down to the valley so shady. He whistled and he sang till the cream was dry, and he won the heart of the lady. Ah-dee-doo, ah-dee-doo, da-day, ah-dee-doo, ah-dee-day. And he sang till the cream was rang, and he won the heart of a lady. She left her father's castle gate, she left her own fond lover, she left her servants and estate to follow the gypsy rover. He whistled and he sang till the queen was rang, and he won the heart of a lady. Her father saddled up his fastest steed, he roamed the valleys all over, he sought his daughter at great speed, and the whistling gypsy rode.
Try the chorus.
Ah-dee-doo, ah-dee-doo, da-day, ah-dee-doo, ah-dee-day. He whistled and he sang till the cream was dry, and he won the heart of a lady. He came at last to a mansion fine, down by the river to lay. There was music and there was wine for the gypsy and his lady.
Try it on your own.
Ah-dee-doo, ah-dee-doo, ah-dee-doo,
see my father, she said. But Lord, all these lands are over, and I will stay till my dying day with the whistling gypsy rover.
The last time.
Adi-do, adi-do, ba-day. Adi-do, adi-day. He whistled and he sang till the green woods rang, and he won the heart of a lady.
You are very good, very good. Do you ever notice what all these lovey-dovey songs are? Always about a couple in their teens or their early 20s. There are very few songs about the same couple 35 years later when they've learned everything about each other. Well, there's an old couple that we know are still in love. They live near us. We come from a very isolated part of the world, South Tipperary in Ireland. Across the River Shore from us are the Cumra Mountains. And there are still people living in there in the valleys of the Cumra Mountains, the old-fashioned way, very isolated. They still live in old white thatched cottages. Keep this couple, they keep a cow, two cows, and they grow their own vegetables, cut their own turf for firing. They're very self-sufficient and very isolated, but it's a lovely life. The husband only comes out of that valley twice a year, and that's a very exciting occasion. He prepares for days before coming out. And it's usually to the fair of Clonmel. And on one such occasion, he was to the fair of Clonmel selling calves. Came out in the horse and car, 4 o'clock in the morning. And when he finished selling his calves, he went prowling around all the excitement of the fair. And he came to that part of all fairs where you have stalls selling trinkets. And he found something there that he had never seen in his life before, and that was a small hand mirror. He picked up this hand mirror, he took one look in it, and he said, "Mother of God, 'tis a picture of me father." And being very fond of his father, he was very emotional about this, and he bought the thing. And on the way back to the mountain in the horse and car, he was thinking of his father, and he was going to show this to his wife when he got home. But then he remembered that when the father was alive, they hadn't gotten along very well anyway. So he decided to keep this hide from her for the present. When he got home, he walked in the door. She took one look at him. With that strange power that all women seem to have, she knew he had a secret. She being a little vain, she thought it might be another woman he met at the fair. But she said nothing. He said nothing. When she wasn't looking, he hid the mirror under the mattress. And the following day, when he was out working in the fields, she went around looking for clues. She found the mirror, took one look in it, and said, "I knew 'twas another woman," says she. And an ugly-looking old bitch she is, too, says she. Well, that's, as I said, is sort of the subject of the next song, which is about a couple who just lived married too long, fed up with each other. In this case, she tries to get rid of him in a unique way. She first tries to make him blind, and then when he can't see what's happening, she tries to drown him. It's an old Irish love song called "The Old Woman from Wexford."
There was an old woman in Wexford town did dwell. She loved her husband dearly, but another man twice as well.
Now it me right fell at the tail idle, and me right fell Laura Lee.
One day she went to the doctor, some medicine for to find. She said, "Doctor, give me something that'll make me husband blind."
Now it me right fell at the tail idle, and me right fell Laura Lee.
He said, "Feed him eggs and marrow bones and make him sup them all. It won't be so very long after that Lee won't see you at all.
Oh, it be right for little Lionel and be right for Laura Lee.
So she fed him eggs and marrow bones and made him sup them all. It wasn't so very long after that Lee couldn't see the wall.
Oh, it be right for little Lionel and be right for Laura Lee.
Says he, I'd go and drown myself, but that might be a sin. Says she, I'll go to the water's edge and I'll help to push you in.
Oh, it me right for little a little and me right for Laura Lee.
The old woman, she went back a bit to get to run and go. The old man blithely stepped aside and she went in below.
Oh, it me right for little a little and me right for Laura Lee.
Oh, how loudly did she roar and how loudly did she bawl. And I howled and wished, old woman, says he, sure I can't see you at all.
Oh, it me right for little a little and me right for Laura Lee.
Now she swam and swam and swam and swam till she came to the further brim. The old man got a long latch pole and he pushed her for the rin.
Oh, it me right for little Lionel and me right for Laura Lee.
Now eggs or eggs and marrow bones might make your husband blind, but if you want to drown him you must keep up close behind.
Oh, it me right for little Lionel and me right for Laura Lee. Bum, bum.
Every summer in the west of Ireland, we have one of the big annual events of the year, which is the Galway Races. And it's a week of horse racing, but a whole lot else besides. Because people come from all over Ireland and all over the world and go wild in Galway for a week. It's a little bit like an Irish Mardi Gras, if you can imagine such a thing. Lots of carnivals and sideshows and singing and dancing in the streets. Fiddlers and pickpockets on every corner, everybody having a great old time. And it really hasn't changed much at all in the last couple of hundred years, except I don't think you can still get crubeans there. A crubean is a great Irish delicacy. It's a pig's foot that's boiled for about 5 or 6 hours. After about 10 pints of Guinness, it tastes wonderful, but otherwise, be very careful. Here's a song all about the Galway races.
As I rode out through Galway town to seek for recreation on the 17th of August, my mind being elevated, there was multitudes assembled with their tickets at the station. My eyes began to dazzle and I go on to see the races with me whack, ball the dough, ball the dithery idle.
And it's there you'll see confectioners with sugar sticks and dainties, lozenges and oranges and lemonade and raisins, gingerbreads and spices to accommodate the ladies, and a big crubeen for threepence to be picking while you're able.
Oh, it be whack, while the dough, while the dithery idle.
And it's there you'll see the pipers and the fiddlers competing, the nimble-footed dancers, and they tripping o'er the daisies, while others cried cigars and lights and bills for all the races, the colours of the jockeys, the price and horses' ages.
Whip me whack, all the dough, all the dithery idle.
There was passengers from Limerick and more from Tipperary, the boys from Connemara and the Clare unmarried maidens, and people from Cork City who were loyal, true and faithful. They brought home the Fenian prisoners from dying in foreign nations.
With me whack, ball the dough, ball the dithery idle day.
It's there you'll see the jockeys, and they mounted on so stately, the blue, the pink, the red, the green, the emblem of our nation. When the bell was rung for starting, all the horses seemed impatient. I thought they never stood on ground, their speed was so amazing.
Oh, with me whack, ball the dough, ball the dithery idle. There was 500,000 people there of all denominations, the Catholic, the Protestant, the Jew and Presbyterian. There was yet no animosity, no matter what persuasion, but a fortune and hospitality induced some fresh acquaintance. With me whack, fall the dough, fall the dithery idle. With me whack, fall the dough, fall the dithery idle.
I'm sure that some of you know what an orange man is. you don't, the ones who don't, I'll explain to you. He's one of those fellows who loves the Queen of England and hates the Pope. And there's a story told about an orange man one time, believe it or not, who went to heaven. Well, he got as far as the gates of heaven, at least. Kicked up an awful row because he wouldn't be let in. Of course, St. Peter had to be called out. And he said, my dear man, he said, why should we leave you into heaven? He says, because I am the bravest man that ever lived. Tim Peter looked at him and said, my God, that's an awful big boast to make. What did you ever do on earth to make you the bravest man that ever lived? I walked down the Catholic Falls Road in Belfast waving the British Union Jack flag. By God, St. Peter said, that was a brave thing to do. When did you do this, by the way? About 4 minutes ago, sources say. Oh, I give her the walk, you're right. I think the sound that follows explains itself. In a mean abode on the Shankill Road lived a man named William Bloat. He had a wife, the bane of his life, who always got his goat. So one day at dawn, with her nightdress on, he slit her bloody throat. He was glad he had done there what he had, and she lay there stiff and still. Till suddenly the thought of that angry law filled his soul with an awful chill. So to finish the fun, he so well begun, he decided himself to kill. So he took the sheets from his wife's cold feet and he twisted them into a roll. He hung himself from the pantry shelf. 'Twas an easy end, let's hope. With his dying breath and a face in death, he solemnly cursed the Pope. But the strangest turn of the whole concern is only just beginning. For he went to hell, but his wife got well, and she's still alive and sinning. For the razor blade was English made, but the sheets were Irish linen.
Much for chauvinism. There's a great tradition in Ireland for the making of illegal booze. And because it's illegal, it has all these secret names. It's mostly known as potcheen, but it's also known as Mountain Dew, a moonshine, white lightning, red biddy.
Holy water.
Holy water, yes. And it's a lovely drink. A lot of people have gone to Ireland forgetting that it's illegal. You can't just walk into a shop and buy it. But I'll give you a little advice. If you go to Ireland, there are two places you might get potcheen: the local police station or the local convent. The Reverend Mother keeps it for medicinal purposes, of course. Here's a little song about Mountain Dew.
Hi, the diddly diddle, diddly diddle, diddly diddle, diddly diddle, diddly diddle, diddly diddle, diddly.
Let grasses grow and waters flow in a free and easy way, but give me enough of the fine old stuff that's made near Galway Bay. And policemen all from Donegal, Sligo and Leitrim too, we'll give them a sip and we take a sip of the real old Mountain Dew.
Hi, little diddly diddle, diddly doodle, diddle diddly diddle, diddly 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 diddly. Hi, diddly 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 diddly.
At the foot of the hill there's a neat little still where the smoke curls up to the sky. By the smoke and the smell you can plainly tell that there's butchering doing nearby. It fills the
the air with odor rare, and betwixt both me and you. When home you stroll, you can take a bowl or a bucket at the Mountain Dew. Hi, the diddy 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 lum, diddy 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 lum, diddy 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 diddy. Hi, the diddy 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 lum, diddy 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 lum, diddy 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 diddy. Now learned men who use the pen have wrote your praises high. That sweet pagine from Ireland green is still from wheat and rye. Throw away your pills, it'll cure all ills, be a pagan, a Christian or Jew. Take off your coat and graze your throat with the real old Mountain Dew. Why the diddly diddly dum diddly doodly dum diddly doodly diddly 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 diddly.
Oh, thank God they're not all up like that. We have some very quiet songs, too, from Ireland. This next song is a serious song. And yet, even though it is a serious song, it was number one on the hit parade on our national radio for almost a year. And this song was written by a young poet and songwriter. He went to France on his holidays one summer. And he came across that part of France where the dead of World War I are buried. Thousands and thousands of gravestones scattered over the hillsides. Today, of course, is a very appropriate day for remembering. But this young poet sat in front of one of the gravestones and he wrote this lovely song. The song, the gravestone said very simply, William McBride, age 19.
Well, how do you do, young Willie McBride? Do you mind if I sit here down by your graveside and rest for a while, neath the warm summer sun? I've been walking all day, and I'm nearly done. I see by your gravestone you were only 19 when you joined the great falling in 1916. I hope you died well, and I hope you died clean. Our young Willie McBride, was it slow and obscene? Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the five lowly? Did they sound the dead march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes play the flowers of the forest? Did you leave any wife or a sweetheart behind? In some faithful heart is your memory enshrined? Although you died back in 1916, in that faithful heart are you forever 19? Or are you a stranger without even a name, enclosed down forever behind a glass frame? In an old photograph, torn, tattered and stained, and faded to yellow in a brown leather frame. Did they beat the drum slowly? Did they play the five lowly? Did they sound the dead march as they lowered you down? Did the band play the last post and chorus? Did the pipes lay the flowers of the forest. The sun now it shines on the green fields of France. There's a warm summer breeze makes the red poppies dance. And look how the sun shines from under the clouds. There's no gas, no barbed wire, there's no guns firing now. But here in this graveyard, it's still no man's land. The countless white crosses in mute witness stand. To man's blind indifference, to his fellow man, to a whole generation that were butchered and damned. Do they beat the drum slowly? Do they play the fife lowly? Do they sound the dead march as they lowered ye down? Get a band play the last host in chorus. Get the pipes, play the flowers of the forest. A young Willie McBride, I can't help wonder why. If those who lie here know why they have died, did they believe when they answer the call? Do they really believe that this war would end wars? The sorrow, the suffering, the glory, the pain, the killing, the dying, was all that in vain. For young Willie McBride, it all happened again, and again, and again, and again, and again. Do they beat the drum slowly? Do they play the fife lowly? Do they sound the dead march as they lowered it down? Do the band play the last post in chorus? To the pipes play the flowers of the forest. Enough.
He'd be looking for more money if you keep that up. Yeah. When we first started traveling around singing those songs, we sometimes had to stay in kind of cheap hotels. Lousy lodgings, we used to call them. And they were lousy. That was before DDT. You'd be devoured in some of these places. The worst place we ever stayed in was a little place outside Glasgow. Here's the story of the night we spent in Rothesay.
Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, da-da-ma-do-a-da-da-no, da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, the night we went to Rothesay.
One New Year's Eve in Glasgow town, when all we had was half a crown, a bunch of us thought we'd prowl around and find some fun in Rothesay.
We wandered down Victoria Street, and we didn't care for the snow or sleet. And at half past two, with aching feet, we found ourselves in Rothesay.
Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, da-da-ma-do-a-da-da-no, da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, the night we went to Rothesay.
Tom Clancy here, who's a bit of a lout, what? Said he'd treat us all to a pint of stout. So as quick as a wink, we all set out
for a public house in Rozzio.
Says I, me lads, I'd like to sing.
Says I, I'll no do such a thing.
I said, clear the room and we'll make a ring. I'll fight ye all in Rozzio.
Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, da-da-ma-do-a-dad-no. Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, the night we went to Rozzio.
Then we had to find a place to sleep.
We were all too drunk to even creep.
We found a place that was really cheap. In a boarding house in Rozzio.
We all lay down to take our ease when somebody happened for to sneeze.
And he wakened half a million fleas in a single room in Rozzio. Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, da-da-ma-do-a-dad-no. Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, the night we went to Rozzio.
There were several different kinds of pests.
They ran and jumped inside our vests.
They got in our hair and they built their nests. And they cried,
hurrah for Rozzio!
Says I think we'll head for home.
And we swore we never more would roam. And we scratch and still as we sing this poem of the night we went to Rozzio. Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, da-da-ma-do-a-dad-no. Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, the night we went to Rozzio. Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, da-da-ma-do-a-dad-no. Da-da-ma-do-a-dum-a-day, the night we went to Rozzio.
Turn up again, Mike.
There was an Irishman one time working on a building site. So many Irishmen have done over the years. But this particular fella was a bit misfortunate. And he had one of those days. You know those days that start out bad and get progressively worse as they go along? By the end of the day, this particular fellow was in such bad condition that he couldn't work at all for weeks. And he was faced with a real problem. He had to write a letter to his boss to explain what happened to him and why he was unable to go into work. The song is called Dear Boss. Dear boss, I write this note to you to tell you of my plight. And at the time of writing, I am not a pretty sight. Me body is all black and blue and me face a deadly grey. And I hope you'll understand why Paddy's not at work today. I was working on the 14th floor, some bricks I had to clear. And thrown them down from such a height was not a good idea. The foreman wasn't very pleased, he being an awful sod. And he said I'd have to take them down the ladder in me hod. Now shifting all those bricks by hand, it seemed so awful slow. So I hoisted up a barrel and secured a rope below. But in my haste to do the job, I was too blind to see that a barrel full of building bricks was heavier than me. Now when I came down, I cut the rope and the barrel fell like lead. And clinging tightly to the rope, I started up instead. I shot up like a rocket and to my dismay I found that halfways up I met the bloody barrel coming down. Now the barrel broke me shoulder as to the ground it sped. And when I reached the top I struck the pulley with me head. I still clung on though numbed and shocked from this almighty blow. And the barrel spilled out half the bricks 14 floors below. Now when the bricks had fallen from the barrel to the floor, sure I then outweighed the barrel and I started down once more. Still clinging tightly to the rope, I headed for the ground, and I fell among the broken bricks that were all scattered round. I lay there moaning on the floor, sure I thought I'd passed the worst. And the barrel struck the pulley wheel and didn't the bottom burst. A shower of bricks came down on me, sure I hadn't got a hope. And as I was losing consciousness, I let go the bloody rope. Now barrel it being heavier, it started down once more, and it landed right across me as I lay there on the floor. I broke 3 ribs and my left arm, and I can only say that I hope you'll understand why Paddy's not at work today.
During the latter half or the end of the 18th century, there was rebellions all over the world. You had the French Revolution, and here in America you had the War of Independence. We in Ireland had a rebellion in 1798, and the song that commemorates that rebellion to this day is a song about a young man who was executed on Tone Bridge in County Antrim. His name was Roddy McCarley.
Oh, see the fleet-foot horse of men who speed with faces wan. From farmstead and from fisher's cut along the banks of Ban, they come with vengeance in their eyes. Too late are they. For young Roddy McCorley goes to die on the bridge of Toome today. Up the narrow street he stepped, smiling proud and young. About the hemp rope on his neck, the golden ringlets clung. There is never a tear in his blue eyes, but glad and bright are they. As young Roddy McCorley goes to die on the bridge of Toome today. When he last stepped off the street, his shining pike in hand, behind him marched in grim array a stalwart earnest band. For Antrim town, for Antrim town, he led them to the fray. And young Roddy McCorley goes to die on the bridge of Toome today. There is never a one of all your dead who bravely fell in marches to his fate on the bridge of Toome today. Through to the last, through to the last, he treads the upward way. And young Roddy McCorley goes to die on the bridge of Toome today.
We'll sing you a little song about describing the beauty of the countryside and the mountains and the valleys and lakes of Ireland called Come by the Hills. But before we do the song, I'd like to introduce it by reciting one of William Butler Yeats' poems. In the early days, in his early poetry, he wrote this poem. He had gone to live in London and felt very lonesome and homesick for Sligo, where he had been living. And he wrote, "I will arise and go now, and go to Innisfree, and a small cabin built there of clay and wattles made. 9 bean rows will I have there, and a hive for the honeybee, and I live alone in the bee loud glade. And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the vales of morn to where the cricket sings, where midnight's all a glimmer and noon a purple glow, and evening full of the linnet's wings. I will arise and go now for always, night and day. I hear lake waters lapping with low sounds by the shore.
When I stand on the roadway or on the pavements gray, I hear it in the deep heart's core.
Come by the hills to the land where fancy is free, and stand where the peaks meet the sky and the lochs meet the sea, where the rivers run clear and the bracken is gold in the sun, and the cares of tomorrow must wait till this day is done.
Come by the hills to the land where life is a song, and sing while the birds fill the air with their joy all day long, where the trees sway in time and even the wine seems in tune, and the cares of tomorrow must wait till this day is done.
Come by the hills to the land where legend remains, where stories of old fill the heart and may yet come again, where the past has been lost and the future has still to be won, and the cares of tomorrow must wait till this day is done.
Thank you. Of all the hundreds of thousands of young men who left Ireland to go abroad, most of them came over here, but a lot of them went the 16,000 miles down to Australia, and one of them became known as the Wild Colonial Boy.
There was a wild colonial boy, Jack Duggan was his name. He was born and raised in father's only son, his mother's pride and joy, and dearly did his parents love the wild colonial boy.
At the early age of 16 years he left his native home, and to Australia's sunny shore he was inclined to roam. He robbed the rich, he helped the poor, he shot James McAvoy.
A terror to Australia was the wild colonial boy.
One morning on the prairie, as Jack he rode along, a listening to the mockingbird singing a cheerful song. Up stepped a band of troopers, Kelly, Davis and Fitzroy.
They all set out to capture him, the wild colonial boy. Surrender now, Jack Duggan, for you see we're 3-1. Surrender in the Queen's high name, you are a thundering son. Jack threw two pistols from his belt, he proudly waved them high. I'll fight, but not surrender, said the wild colonial boy. He fired a shot at Kelly, received a fatal wound. A bullet pierced his proud young heart from the pistol off its right. And that was how they captured him, the wild colonial boy.
Paddy has dared me to do an English song.
I will.
A song of great social significance. I'll get that out in a minute. Song of great social significance. We'd like to dedicate this song to the present Conservative government in London. And Mrs. Thatcher, of course, who loves us dearly. This song is called "They're Moving Father's Grave to Build a Sewer." Oh, they're moving Father's grave to build a sewer. They're moving him regardless of expense. They've dug up his remains to put in 5-inch drains to irrigate some posh bloke's residence.
His residence.
Now, what's the use of having a religion if when you're dead your troubles never cease? If some posh city chap wants a pipeline to his privy, they'll never let a British workman rest in peace.
Oh, rest in peace.
Now, in his lifetime, Father never was a quitter.
Never.
I'm sure that he won't be a quitter now. For when the job's complete, he'll haunt that privy seat. And he'll only let them go when he'll allow.
When he'll allow.
Now, won't there be some blooming consternation? And won't these city chappies rant and rave? Which is more than they deserve for having the bleeding nerve to muck around with a British workman's grave. Oh, my old man said, follow the band and don't dilly-dally on the way. I've went the band with me old man in it. I follow on with me old couple in it. I dilly, I dally, I dally and I dilly. I lost my way and don't know where to roam. Oh, you can't trust the specials, look, the old-time coppers, when you can't find your way out.
I'm getting a bit old for that kind of thing. We're going to sing a song that's a great old favorite of ours, along with one we've been singing for years and years. We learned it from an old man in Ireland, an old man whose whole life had been sweetened by the drinking of punch. And one night, just before the pub closed, and he'd been there all day, he growled out this song for us as the world was slipping out of focus for him. It's a song that starts out very quietly, very poetically, and rapidly deteriorates. Like St. Patrick's Day, you know. We'd like you to join us in a jug of punch. One pleasant evening in the month of June, as I was sitting with my glass and spoon, a small bird sat on an ivy bunch, and the song he sang was the jug of punch.
Tooraloo, 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 tooraloo. A small bird sat on an ivy bunch, and the song he sang was the jug of punch.
What more diversion can a man desire than to sit him down by an alehouse fire? Upon his knee a pretty wench,
aye, and on the table a jug of punch.
Tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay, tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay. Upon his knee a pretty wench, aye, and on the table a jug of punch.
Let the doctors come with all their art, they'll make no impression upon my heart. Even the cripple forgets his hunch when he's snug outside of a jug of punch.
Tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay, tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay. Even the cripple forgets his hunch when he's snug outside of a jug of punch.
And if I get drunk, well, the money's me own, and them don't like me, they can leave me alone. I'll tune me fiddle and I'll rosin me bow, and I'll be welcome wherever I go.
And tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay, tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay. I'll tune me fiddle and I'll rosin me bow, and I'll be welcome wherever I go. And when I'm dead, I end in my grave, no costly tombstone will I have. Just lay me down in my native heat with a jug of punch at my head and feet. And tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay, tooraloo-ra-loo, tooraloo-ra-lay. Just lay me down in my native heat with a jug of punch at my head and feet.
While we're on the subject, the word whiskey is derived from the Gaelic Uisce Baha, which means the water of life. I just thought I'd pass that on to you. There was a builder's laborer in Dublin at the turn of the century by the name of Tim Finnegan who was very fond of this same water of life. And one Monday morning, after a wonderful weekend, he felt awful. I'm sure most of you know the feeling. He had the mother and father of a hangover. But being a builder's laborer, he still had to climb that ladder with a hod full of bricks. So to give himself courage, the poor man, he took a drop of the hard stuff. But when he got to the top of the ladder, he got a dizzy spell. He fell, broke his skull, dead as a doornail. They say it is the drop that killed him. But they took him home and they had a wake for him. Now this was none of your funeral parlor jobs. This was a traditional Irish wake. And let me tell you that is a rare institution. An Irish wake is the most peculiar thing in the whole world. It starts off very respectably. Little old ladies talking very quietly. Those little old ladies dressed nice white crocheted blouses and things. Talking about the corpse, how well he looks. They never saw him looking better, which was probably true. They're drinking tea away, and then the men come in later and the heavy stuff comes out. Then things begin to degenerate. And by nightfall, you have a fantastic hooly going. Well, there's a great ballad about Tim Finnegan's wake, and James Joyce, the Irish author, was familiar with this ballad. He was fascinated with having the idea of having the water of life at a wake. And also the incident in which, during a row, some of the same water of life accidentally spilled on the corpse with hilarious results. Now we're going to sing for you. James Joyce wrote a long, complicated book based on this ballad. We're going to sing for you the ballad. But first, by way of introduction, my brother Thomas will now recite for you the entire novel by James Joyce, Finnegan's Wake.
River run past Eve and Adam, from swerve of shore to bend of bay, takes us by a commodious ficus of recirculation back to Holt Castle and environs. Now that's the first paragraph of the first chapter of James Joyce's book, Finnegan's Wake. There are 687 more pages, so settle down. Big Mr. Finnegan of the stuttering hand, free man's maurer, lived in the broadest way imaginable in his rushlet, too far back for messuages before Joshua and Judges had given us Numbers or Helvidicus had committed Deuteronomy. Do you dig that much so far? Well, during mighty odd years, this man of hard cement and edifices in Toperstorp piled bildung, super bildung upon the banks of the Livers for the so-and-sos. A Woolworth of a skyscraper of most awful height, entirely originating from next to nothing, with a burn and bush above of its bubble top, and with Lonzo tools a-slithering up and Amazon buckets clattering down. Now the first was he to bear arms and a name, Wassily Boozily of Rosengabum. Oh, ho, ho, Mr. Finn, you're going to be fined again. Ha, 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 Mr. Fun, you're going to be Mr. Finn again. A dim, he stuttered from the ladder. Damn, he was good.
Tim Finnegan lived in Walking Street, a gentle Irishman, mighty odd. He had a brogue so rich and sweet, till the rise of the world he carried a heart. 'Tis he in a sort of a tippler's way, with a love for the lick of poor Tim was born. To help him on with his work each day, to the drop of the crater every morn. Whack on the ladder, dance to your partner, welcome the floor your trotter shake. Wasn't it the truth that told you lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake?
One morning Tim felt rather full, his head felt heavy, which made him shake. He fell from the ladder, and he broke his skull, and they carried him home, his corpse to wake. They rolled him up in a nice clean sheet, and they laid him out upon the bed, with a bucket of whiskey at his feet, and a barrel of porter at his head.
Whack for the ladder, dance to your partner, while the floor your trotters shake. Wasn't it the truth they told you, lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake?
His friends assembled at the wake, and Mrs. Finnegan called for lunch, for she served them tea and cakes, then pipes, tobacco, and whiskey punch. Biddy O'Brien began to cry, what a nice clean corpse did you ever see? Tim of O'Neill, why did you die? And a elder gop said, Biddy McGee,
oh, white brother, now that's your partner, let the floor your trotters shake. Wasn't it the truth they told you, lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake?
Then Maggie O'Connor took up the job. Oh, Biddy, says she, you're wrong, I'm sure. But Biddy gave her a belt in the gob, and she left her sprawling on the floor.
Then the war did soon engage, was woman to woman and man to man. Shillelagh law was all the rage, and a row and a ruction soon began. Whack for the lad, or dance to your partner, with the glory of trotter's shake. Wasn't it the truth they told you, lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake?
Then Mickey Maloney raised his head when the bucket of whiskey flew at him. It missed and fallen on the bed. The liquor scattered over Tim. You got he revived, see how he rises. Timothy rising from the bed, saying, whirl your whiskey around like blazes. London Jesus, do you think I'm dead?
Whack for the lad, now dance to your partner, welcome for your trotter's shake. Wasn't it the truth they told you, lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake? Whack for the lad, now dance to your partner, welcome for your trotter's shake. Wasn't it the truth they told you, lots of fun at Finnegan's Wake?
How's your old one? Came off.
Sing with us.
And it's no, nay, never.
One, two, three, four.
No, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more. I've been a wild rover for many a year. I've spent all my money on whiskey and beer. But now I'm returning with gold in great store, and I never will play the wild rover no more. And it's no, nay, never. No, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more.
I went into an alehouse that I used to frequent, and I told the landlady my money was spent. Well, I asked her for credit, but she answered me, nay, such a custom as yours I can get any day.
And it's no, nay, never. No, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no more.
And out of my pocket I took sovereigns bright, and the landlady's eyes opened wide with delight. She said, I have whiskey and wines of the best, and the words that I said, they were only in jest.
And it's no, nay, never. No, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. Confess what I've done, and I'll ask them to pardon their prodigal son. And if they'll caress me as oft times before, then I never will play the wild rover no more. And it's it's no, nay, never. No, nay, never, no more will I play the wild rover. No, never, no
sing you another one. Here's a great old rebel song from 1798. The rebellion at that time began in the county of Wexford and spread all over Ireland. The signal for the beginning of that uprising was the rising of the moon. Here's the song.
Oh, come tell me, Sean O'Fattle, tell me why you hurry so. Hush me, Bugle, hush and listen. And his cheeks were all aglow. I bear orders from the captain, make you ready quick and soon, for the pigs must be together by the rising of the moon.
By the rising of the moon. By the rising of the moon. For the pigs must be together by the rising of the moon.
Oh, then tell me, Sean O'Fattle, where the gathering is to be. In the old spot by the river, right well known to you and me. One word more for signal token, whistle up the marching tune. With your pike upon your shoulder, by the rising of the moon.
By the rising of the moon. By the rising of the moon. With your pike upon your shoulder, by the rising of the moon.
Out of many a mud wall cabin, eyes were watching through the night. Many a manly heart was throbbing for that coming morning light. Rumors ran along the valleys like the banshee's lonely crone, and a thousand pikes were flashing by the rising of the moon.
By the rising of the moon, by the rising of the moon, and a thousand pikes were flashing by the rising of the moon.
All along the singing river, that dark mass of men were seen.
But above their shining weapons hung their own beloved green.
Death to every foe and traitor, forward strike the marching tune.
And the army boys for freedom, 'tis the rising of the moon.
'Tis the rising of the moon.
'Tis the rising of the moon.
And the army boys for freedom, 'tis the rising of the moon.
Thank you very much. You've been a wonderful audience. And remember, you're immortalized tonight on television. We'd like to leave you with our traditional parting song, The Parting Glass.
Oh, all the money that e'er I've spent, I have spent it in good company. And of all the harm that e'er I've done, alas, it was to none but me. For all I've done, for want of wit, to memory now I can't recall. So fill to me the party. Good night, and joy be with you all. Oh, of all the comrades that e'er I've had, they are sorry for my going away. And of all the sweethearts that e'er I've had, they wish me one more day to stay.
But since it falls unto my lot that I should rise and you should not, I'll gently rise and I'll softly call. Good night, and joy be with you all.
Good night to you all, and thank you very much.
Good night.
Pat, Tom, Bobby, and Robbie. Pat, Tom, Bobby, Clancy, and their nephew Robbie O'Connell. The Clancy brothers in concert, live on the stage from the Hutchins Concert Hall at the Maine Center of the Arts. We hope you've enjoyed tonight's simulcast of the Northeast Winds, which opened this broadcast, and the Clancy Brothers. This has been the first of three Live from the Maine Center programs that MPBN is offering as a 25th anniversary gift to its audiences throughout Maine and Maritime Canada.
Production and broadcast of Live from the Maine Center for the Arts is made possible in part by a grant from the Sawyer family of companies, committed to a clean environment.
The audio engineers for tonight's program were John Fleiderer and Dave Bartlett. The video engineer was Mike Scott. And the microwave engineer was Steve Gray. The engineering supervisor was Dave Roy. And the production crew was Earl Allen, Steve Falloon, Dave Lavender, and Bill Moores. The stage director was Noreen Nelson. And the technical director was Ed Fowler. Tonight's broadcast was produced and directed by Bernie Rossetti. MPBN thanks the Maine Center for the Arts, its director, Joel Katz, and Rolf Olson and Rob Koop of its staff for their cooperation in making this 25th anniversary series possible. This has been a copyrighted presentation of the Maine Public Broadcasting Network. I'm Les Myers of MPBN Radio, and I thank you for joining us.